Okay, good afternoon, students. Today we'll be discussing the topic photosynthesis in higher plants. Okay, so let us go with this topic. Section A, I'm going to start from Singage book. All of you can read the book also if you want simultaneously. Okay, or you can just see on your screen, it is very clear. Section A, topic wise questions. In that topic one, I'm going to start, that is early experiments and site of photosynthesis. Okay, so let us begin with question number one, which is on your screen. Which of the following experiments showed that carbon dioxide is essential for photosynthesis? Okay, experiments conducted by various scientists and the site of photosynthesis. So this was on that only. Which experiment showed that carbon dioxide is essential for photosynthesis? So students, what is photosynthesis? First of all, you should know photosynthesis is a physicochemical process, anabolic process, in which green plants convert carbon dioxide and water to produce sugar with the liberation of oxygen. Okay, so here, which experiment showed that earlier CO2 is essential? Option number A, half leaf experiment. Option two, that is variegated leaf experiment. Option three, Priestley's experiment. And option four is Julius Van Sachs experiment. Okay, so here let us go with different options. Half leaf experiment. What is this half leaf experiment? Half leaf experiment is also called as Mohl's half leaf experiment because it was conducted by scientist Mohl. Okay, what is this experiment? He took a leaf, okay, a normal green colored leaf, and then he exposed the apical half of that leaf to air, and the remaining half of the leaf, the remaining part was dipped in a solution of potassium hydroxide, KOH solution. I repeat my words. The first half of the leaf was exposed to atmosphere. Remaining half of the leaf was dipped in a beaker, which or a container, which was containing potassium hydroxide solution. So what is the role of potassium hydroxide here? Potassium hydroxide will absorb this carbon dioxide, converting it to potassium carbonate. That means in the beaker, carbon dioxide is not available to the leaf to carry out photosynthesis. Then when this setup was allowed to remain for certain time, and after that, the availability of starch was found out, it was shown that the leaf, which was the part of the leaf which was dipped in potassium hydroxide, not any result for starch, whereas the remaining part, which was exposed to atmosphere, ends of starch. So this experiment clearly must for photosynthesis. Aside, you cannot think of photosynthesis. Green plants require CO2. Block the availability of CO2, any solution like cannot carry out photosynthesis. Option experiment is the right option. B, C, D also. Variegated leaf experiment differentially. Okay. If you just compare this variegated leaf, have a green color with a black paper, and both of them to undergo very clearly, you can give result for if it would be covered with a black paper. This variegates it indicates the pigments are precisely the experiment. See in the next question. Okay, so question is option A, half. Now, let us go in half leaf experiment, absorb carbon dioxide. Okay, just now I said that potassium hydroxide solution was used because it converts into potassium carbonate and makes it unavailable for photosynthesis. So option B is the right answer for question number two. Okay, so let us go to question number three here on your screens. All of you can concentrate. Question number three, the following hypothesis plants restore to the air whatever breathing animals and burning candles remove was given by. So this was one of the eminent scientists who said, what is the statement? Plants restore to the air whatever breathing animals and burning candles remove. So this experiment is nothing but it is called as Joseph Priestley's experiment, students. Okay, so Joseph Priestley conducted an experiment. I'll just show you, there is a diagram here for question number 6. You can concentrate. This diagram, this setup is for Priestley's experiment. What experiment he conducted? He first of all, he used a burning candle and a living mouse and covered it with a bell jar. Then in the second instant, what did he observe is the living animal, that is the mouse, will consume the available air, and when available air or oxygen is not, it is used up, the combustion process will stop and the candle will stop burning. Okay, the same setup, in this setup a mint plant was introduced by Priestley. Okay, and after introducing mint plant, he could find out that this mint plant was restoring whatever the air which was consumed by this living animal as well as by the process of combustion. So two things were happening here. One is respiration by this living animal, and another one was by this candle. So both of them use up atmospheric oxygen. So that's the reason the mint plant would be used to restore, because mint plant is one which consumes carbon dioxide and so in this way he Priestley said that this experiment, this hypothesis, let us come back to this hypothesis. I was telling you that, yes, here question number 3, plants restore to the air whatever breathing animals and burning candles remove. So this was given by Priestley. He was the first man. Plants are used for liberating oxygen. Okay, so the option B, if you see Jan Ingenhouse, his contribution is different. I'll discuss in the next questions, coming questions, don't worry. T.W. Engelmann discussed, okay, and Cornelius Van Niel also, their contributions also I'll discuss in the incoming questions. For question number 3, option A is the right answer. Now I'm going to question number 4. All of you can see on your screens. Question number 4. Yes. Which of the following scientists showed that it is the green part of the plants that would release oxygen? Okay, which scientists prove that it is only the green part, greenish part of the plant, the non-green parts or the underground parts like roots? Okay, green parts which would restore or release the oxygen. Okay, who said this? This is the question. Okay, so options, let us see. Joseph Priestley. Students have said that Joseph Priestley's experiment, I have just explained before, this is not the answer for this question. Jan Ingenhouse was the first person to tell that yes, it is the plant structure that is responsible to release the oxygen. Okay, so he was the first person to contribute to this understanding. T.W. Engelmann was the person who gave the first absorption spectrum. Cornelius Van Niel, this the contribution of this person, Cornelius Van Niel, is for, like, you know, evolution of oxygen. I will tell you in the further questions. So for this question 4, option B, Jan Ingenhouse is the answer for question number 4. Okay, let us go to question number 5. Who found that green parts in plant is where glucose is made? Okay, glucose is made, and that the glucose is usually stored as starch. Okay, so another scientist contribution we are discussing here. Okay, what was the contribution? The green part contributing to photosynthesis was told by Ingenhouse. But the question 4 and 5, there is a slight difference here. In question number 5, what is asked is not only releasing of oxygen, but the end product of photosynthesis, that is formation of sugars, that is glucose, is made by the green plants, and that's stored in the form of starch. Okay, so monosaccharide is converting into stored starch. Who was the scientist who said this? Option Julius Van Sachs. Okay, option B, Cornelius Van Niel, T.W. Engelmann, Jan Ingenhouse. So students, for this the answer is Julius Van Sachs. Julius Van Sachs was the first person to report that green parts in the plants is nothing but those which are rich in cloacae, because today we know very clearly that photosynthesis is occurring, and in plants glucose is synthesized at the end of photosynthesis, and that glucose is polymerized and stored. So it was the contribution of Van Sachs who said this. The other scientist, Ingenhaus, just before I have discussed, Cornelius van Niel is for a contribution to the reducing substances H2S, where they do not liberate oxygen. That was the contribution. I'll discuss that, don't worry. So you concentrate on question number 5. Question number 5, the answer is option A, Julius van Sachs. Okay, now let us go to question number 6 here in your books. All of you can concentrate. Question number 6. So question number 6 is a diagram based question. You can see on your screens. The following setup is called as, few minutes back only I have explained this diagrammatic representation. Let us see the options. Engelmann experiment, okay, Jan Ingenhaus experiment, option C, Priestley's experiment, and option D is Cornelius van Niel experiment. So students, what did I say, what experiment it is? It is nothing but option C, that is Priestley's experiment, where he was the first person who said that the used up consumed oxygen is restored by photosynthesis in plants. Okay, so he used some other terms also, you should know, that is called as phlogisting. Okay, what is the word I am using here? Phlogisting, phlogestin. Phlogisting is replaced by D. Okay, phlogisting is the foul air. D, phlogisting is nothing but the pure air. In this way also you can conclude this experiment. So question number 6, option C is, let us now move on to question number 7, which is there on your screen. Question number 7, which scientist is located in special body? Chloroplast within the plant cells. Okay, now this is a slightly new thing. Which scientist showed that green substance that is in plant? Chlorophyll. What is this chlorophyll, students? It is the pigment, main pigment, which is responsible for photosynthesis, present in all higher plants as well as lower photosynthetic organisms like blue-green algae you take, even higher algae you take, some protists you take like Euglena, they all have chlorophylls, which is located in chloroplast. Yes, definitely, pigments are found in chloroplast within the cells. So who showed this for the first time is the question. Let us see the options. Julius van Sachs, Cornelius van Niel, Engelmann, Jan Ingenhaus. Okay, so what is the answer for this question? The answer for this question is Julius van Sachs. Okay, if you just remember Julius van Sachs, I have told that in question number 5, I'm just going here also, I said in question number 5, Julius van Sachs is the answer, because he said that glucose is made and glucose is stored in the form of starch. For this also Julius made one more contribution, and what is that is, he said that green substance is located inside the chloroplast. So for this question also, question number 7, again Julius van Sachs is the answer. Okay, I hope I'm clear with this. Two things he said at a time. One is location of this pigment, another one is formation or synthesis of glucose. Question is the answer. Let's go to question number 8 here on your screens. Question number 8. First action spectrum of synthesis was described by, coming across again and again, because these main scientists who contributed to our demonstrations or photosynthesis, students. So again, the options were Julius van Sachs, Julius van Niel, T.W. Jan Ingenhaus. Okay, so first action spectrum. So meaning of action spectrum. What is action spectrum? Action spectrum is nothing but graphical representation which shows rate of photosynthesis versus, okay, rate of photosynthesis versus absorption. There are two types of spectra. One is what we call as absorption spectra, another one is called as action spectra. So the first action spectrum was shown by which scientist is asked here. Van Sachs is not the person. Cornelius Van Neer is also not the person. T.W. Engelmann is the main person or the scientist who first gave the action spectrum, and he is still remembered for his very great men. Option C is answer. So Engelmann actually, others I would like to brief out here, students. Engelmann actually conducted an experiment on a green alga. Okay, what alga he used in his experiment was Cladophora. The filamentous alga he used, that is nothing but Cladophora. Okay, Cladophora he used in his experiment, and he said that when this alga was exposed to monochromatic light, he concluded ultimately maximum rate of photosynthesis occurs in blue light and red light. This is a very important thing what I'm telling. What did Engelmann conclude? He concluded that maximum rate of photosynthesis occurs in two different light. Okay, so this shows the first action spectrum given by scientist Engelmann. C is the answer. Jan Ingenhouse already has said you that Jan Ingenhouse said that green parts only are responsible for the evolution of oxygen, and this was his contribution. Option D. Option C is the answer for question number 9. Okay, question number 8. I'm sorry. Now question number 9. Action spectrum of photosynthesis roughly resembles what? Okay, so the question asked is action spectrum of photosynthesis resembles what? So what is action spectrum? When you plot a graph, this is the wavelength of light. Two things: x-axis you have wavelength of light, and y-axis is that graph is called as action spectrum. There is one more thing I said: absorption spectrum. Students, what is absorption spectrum? X-axis will be again wavelength of light, and y-axis is nothing but absorbance bond pigments. Okay, difference between action spectrum and absorption spectra. So what did I say, students? In spectrum and absorption, only there is a difference of y-axis. X-axis remains same. In both of them, what is x-axis? Wavelength of light you have to take. Okay, like starting from 400 to 700 nanometer, that is the visible range of light what we see. In action spectrum, y-axis is this. In absorption spectrum, y-axis maxima of different pigments. So in your NCERT book, a statement is given, if you just recall, action spectrum of photosynthesis resembles absorption spectrum of chlorophyll A molecule. So option A is the answer for this question. The absorption of chlorophyll A and action spectrum overlap almost with each other. That's the reason option A is the answer, because you should know that in chlorophyll A absorbs maximally in two different lights, which are those, one is blue light and another one is the red light. So similarly, these two are overlapping with each other. Hence option A is the answer for question number 9. Okay, now we'll go to question number 10. You can see on your screens. Okay, the empirical equation representing the total process of photosynthesis involving oxygen in organisms was given by. Okay, you have to find out the empirical statement here. Okay, let us go to the options. Okay, for question number 10. So we have the options here for question number 10. You have to find out the empirical equation. So I have just zoomed. You can see on your screens. Okay, right. Okay. So option A, let us see. 6 molecules of carbon dioxide combining with 12 molecules of water in the presence of light giving rise to glucose plus typing error here. It should be H2O. Okay, not HO2. And 6 molecules of oxygen. Option B, 6 carbon dioxide, 6 H2O giving 1 glucose plus 6 oxygen. Option C, carbon dioxide plus H2O giving carbohydrate. CH2O is nothing but carbohydrate with the liberation of O2. Option D, glucose combining with oxygen liberating O2 and H2O. So empirical equation is asked, not that chemical reaction. Empirical equation, there you need not balance. So in regard, option C would be the absolute answer here. Okay. Now you may ask me, what about option A and option B? Initially for photosynthesis, this option B, 6CO2 plus 6H2O giving one glucose with six oxygen was actually used for many years. Later this equation was modified to first option. Presently, absolute equation for synthesis, absolute way to synthesis is this first equation. Water giving one glucose, six water. This is the absolute equation for we are following earlier. Okay, by rectification done because six in chemically this equation is balanced. With chemistry point of view, if you see this equation, logically this equation is not correct because six oxygen must be liberated. All the oxygen that is liberated in photosynthesis must come from water. Okay. So water, six molecules of water cannot give six molecules of oxygen. That's the reason this equation was modified, wherein 12 molecules of water can give rise to six molecules of oxygen. Hence, this is the appropriate way of expressing photosynthesis. Question is not asked what is used today. What is the question asked? Empirical equation which was earlier demonstrated. Okay, empirical equation which was first given was option C. Okay, so you have to go for option C for this question. Okay, I hope I'm clear. Option C is the answer. Let us go to question number 11 now. Question number 11, you can see on your screens. You have to recognize the figure and find out the correct matching here. Okay, you have to find out the matching. So what is this figure? Easily you can understand. It is the diagram of chloroplast, students. Okay, chloroplast, double membranous organelle, where you are seeing different structures. So here, if you just see carefully A, B, C, D labeling, what is this A? A is nothing but grana. Okay, A grana, I'm telling, because grana is nothing but that stacking of thylakoids one upon each other. So this is grana. What is B? B is nothing but stroma lamellae. So what are stroma lamellae, students? Stroma lamellae are those which connect the two grana. For example, this is stroma lamellae, this is stroma lamellae. Here also you can see this is stroma lamellae. What is the function of stroma lamellae? They connect the two grana. So A is grana, B is stroma lamellae. Then I'll come to this C, A, B, C. What is C? C here, you can see carefully. C is nothing but starch granule. Okay. C is starch granule. And D, if you see carefully, D is nothing but the lipid droplets. D are the lipid droplets where they are stored. And E, if you see the last labeling here, E is nothing but ribosome. So you have to accordingly find out the labeling. So what did I say? A grana, B stroma lamellae. So here you have to search A grana, B stroma lamellae. You have option A also like this, okay? And option A, if you see, yes, A is grana, B is lamellae, E is ribosome. That is also right. C is starch granule. Yes, it is right. And D is lipid droplet is also right. So we have to go with option A here for this question, okay? So option A is the right answer. Question number 12 on your screens. Question number 12, all of you can see. Cornelius van Niels experiment was on. Okay, so question number 12 is here. Cornelius van Niels experiment was. So what is this experiment? Green alga cladophora. I said you, green alga cladophora was used in whose experiment? It was used in T.W. Engelmann's experiment. Okay, I repeat, cladophora was used in Engelmann's experiment to show the first action spectrum of photosynthesis. So option A is not the answer here, students. Chlorella and senedesmus also is not the answer, because you should know that chlorella and senedesmus, both of them are algae, and they were used in the experiment of Melvin Kelvin. Melvin Kelvin, who designed or who demonstrated the Kelvin cycle, what we call today. So he used chlorella and sanidesmus in his experiments. So B is not the answer. C, purple and green sulfur bacteria. 100% C is the answer for this question. So let me tell you what is this experiment in brief, students. Van Mill said that purple and green sulfur bacteria do not evolve oxygen during photosynthesis. Okay, so what did I say? These bacteria do not evolve oxygen during photosynthesis, and such type of photosynthesis is called as anoxygenic photosynthesis. Okay, why they do not evolve oxygen? I'll just tell you, explain you with this reaction what is given here. All of you can concentrate. Generally, what happens in photosynthesis with carbon dioxide, water is used. Okay, but purple and green sulfur bacteria, they don't use H2O. Okay, what did I say? They don't use H2O. Rather, in place of H2O, they use hydrogen sulfide H2S. So when they use H2S, this O2 is not evolved. Rather, elemental sulfur is formed. They store sulfur in the form of granules. So there is no evolution of oxygen in purple and green sulfur bacteria. Since there is no O2 evolution, such photosynthesis is called as anoxygenic photosynthesis. Whereas when O2 is evolved, such photosynthesis is known as oxygenic photosynthesis. So I hope I am clear with this question. So Van Mill experiment was on these two bacteria. You can give many examples: Chromatium, Chlorobium, Rhodobacter, Rhodospirillum, etc., etc. Okay, so option C is the answer. Option D also, mint plant is given. Mint plant was used in Priestley's experiment. That is the bell jar experiment, which I have already explained. Okay, now let us go to question number 13 on your screens. All of you can concentrate. Engelmann's experiment was on. Yes, I said this earlier also. Engelmann's experiment was on a green. Hello. Hello, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam.
There was some network error. I am just continuing, sir.
No problem.
Okay. Right, students. So where we were discussing this question number 13. I told that Engelmann's experiment question number 13 I was discussing, and I said that for question number 13, what is the answer? Option A, green alga cladophora is the answer. I hope I am clear with this. Okay. Now let us go to question number 14. It is clear on your screen. All of you concentrate. Question number 14, Joseph Priestley's experiment was on. Okay, similar question. Green alga cladophora, chlorella and sanidesmus. Okay, purple and green sulfur bacteria, and option D, mint plant. So students, directly I'll come to option D, mint plant, because already I have explained this D is the answer for this question number 14. Now we are discussing question number 15, which is there on your screen. Okay. who demonstrated that photosynthesis is essentially a light dependent reliable oxidizable compound reduces carbon dioxide to important slightly twisted question. Please concentrate, children. Who demonstrated this is a light dependent in which hydrogen from a suitable oxidizable compound reduces carbon dioxide? So what is happening in photosynthesis? All of you just to see again, I'll go back to this reaction, students. You can see on your screens this reaction A. Here two things are happening. What are those two things? You must know, first of all, carbon dioxide is reduced to carbohydrate and water is oxidized to liberate oxygen. I hope all of you are listening. Carbon dioxide is reduced to carbohydrate and water is oxidized to liberate oxygen. So it's that's why we say photosynthesis is a redox reaction. One is reduced, another one is oxidized. So water is oxidized. Okay, when water is oxidized, you already know in chemistry you study reduction and oxidation. When something is oxidized means it loses electrons, simultaneously protons also are lost. So hydrogens lost. So where these hydrogens go? These hydrogens go to this carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide accepts this hydrogen. In other words, I should say carbon dioxide is accepting electron protons from water. So when it accepts electrons, it gets reduced. So it reduced to what? Reduced to glucose. So I hope I'm clear. CO2 was water oxidized to carbon dioxide. So this is the question here, student number 15. I am coming to here once again. Okay, who demonstrated that hydrogen from a suitable oxidizable compound? It is explained by Niels said photosynthesis, oxygenic and anoxygenic. If water is used as an oxidizable compound, O2 is liberated. If H2S is used as a compound, so what is the answer for this question? Option B, Cornelius Van. Okay, let us go to question number 6. And green sulfur bacteria, the donor is, yes, similar questions. You expect what should be the answer for this question? Obviously, it should be hydrogen sulfide. Use hydrogen sulfide. Option A is the answer. Question number 17, the correct equation that would represent the overall process of photosynthesis. Okay, so again you have to find out the right equation which should express the process of photosynthesis. You have equations here, so I've already explained about them. You have to select one. What are those? 6 CO2, 12 water, 1 glucose, 6 water, 6 oxygen, 6 CO2, 6 water, 1 glucose, 6 oxygen. Okay, one, this is empirical. This question for the ratio, you have to select from A and B. I have already here, you can correct in your books. Okay, H2O, you can make it, but this will be the absolute equation. Why we should use 12 water molecules? Because I said in 12 water molecules only are able to generate 6 molecule oxygen, whereas 6 water molecules cannot do so. So not proper. You have to go for option A. Okay, now we'll go to question 18 on your screen. Question number 18, pigment present, the pigment universally, I'll just go back, universally in all oxygenic patients, pigment in oxygenic plant definitely is present in all oxygenic plants. Oxygenic means those who all plants as well as blue green algae as well as I have them, but chlorophyll A is present in all oxygenic plants. But one thing you should know here, chlorophyll A is absent in some photosynthetic organisms, which are those anoxygenic photosynthesizers. Question given is oxygenic. Those who do not evolve oxygen during photosynthesis, they don't have chlorophyll A. So what are the examples you can give, student? Purple and green sulfur bacteria do not have chlorophyll A. They have some other pigments called as bacteriochlorophylls. Okay, so question number 18, option A is the right answer. Let us go to question number 19. All of you can see this graph which is there on your screen. This is taken from your NCERT book. You have to recognize and find out the matching. So if you just see here in this graph, students, it's not mentioned. So you said absorption spectra where X be what? It must be wavelength, and y axis must be what? Absorption by different pigments. Okay, so wavelength, absorption, these two should be extended here. So you have to find out what is it. So this highest peak which is shown here, okay, which is shown by the X molecule. What is this X molecule? X molecule is nothing but chlorophyll B. Chlorophyll B shows a highest peak in the violet blue region. If you just start a wavelength, I said, from which value you are going to start, students? 400 nanometer up to approximately 700 nanometer. That is what we call as the visible range, 400 to 700. So when you start from 400, it is the violet blue region, we say, okay? Okay, and there you see a molecule which is giving a highest peak. That is nothing but chlorophyll B molecule. And here you have Y, which is nothing but which is whose peak is slightly ahead of this violet blue region, slightly this side. So these molecules Y are nothing but carotenoids. And here you have one more peak which is slightly in this violet region, violet extreme to this side, and this molecule is nothing but chlorophyll A molecule. So chlorophyll A and B both gives a peak in the violet blue indigo region, we say, whereas carotenoids give peak slightly in the yellow region, we say. Are you understanding? So what is X, Y and Z? You have to find out here. X, Y and Z, as I said, you Z is chlorophyll B, okay, and Y is carotenoid. So straight away option A is the answer for this question. Let us go to question number 20. Question number 20, you can just see match the following one column 1 and 2 and choose the correct combination. Okay, pigments are given and their color shown here. Chlorophyll A, usually it is of what color? Chlorophyll A is nothing but bright or blue color. Okay, it shows bright blue color. That is the property of chlorophyll A. Whereas chlorophyll B is nothing but what color? It shows chlorophyll B. It is nothing but the yellow green, or in a say olive green color. Carotenoids are nothing but it is yellow to yellow orange, and xanthophylls are nothing but yellow. So basically carotenoids in chlorophyll A, B, C, D, E, but in higher plants we have only chlorophyll A and B. So in this chapter we are discussing only A and B, students. C, D, E, all those pigments are present in algae, okay, like rhodophyll, say phyophyll, etc. Carotenoids, in that we have xanthophylls and carotenols showing the yellow orange color. So if you just match here, so and B, if you just see, C is matching with 3, okay, and D is matching with basically 1. So here the answer is option number C. Is option C. I'm repeating for question number 20. I hope I'm clear. Now we'll go to question 21. Question number 21, all of you just see, leaf pigments of any green plants can be segments, direct line. leaf pigments, if you want to leaf pigments means which pigments chlorophyll are interested to separate them, which technique you are, fraction, sedimentation, paper chromatography, centrifugation. So what should be the answer? It is nothing but paper chromatography. Paper chromatography is a simple technique, okay, where we use some solvents and all and we separate the pigments, okay, using what, using dipping the paper, or you can use some different organic solvents like acetone and all, where different pigments will show mobility depending upon on their molecular weight. So option C is the answer for question number 21. Question number 22, Joseph Priestley discovered oxygen in the year. Okay, so direct answer, he discovered oxygen, molecular oxygen in the year 1774. Option C is the answer, 1774. Question number 23, photosynthesis is a, okay, physical process, chemical process, physicochemical process, physiochemical process. Slight spelling difference, okay, in C and D. They are looking similar only, but they are different. So, photosynthesis, can you tell it's purely physical process? No, never, because there are many enzymes involved in that, so it cannot be. Even it is not a purely chemical process, because living cells are doing, including activity of many enzymes. Okay, for this is physicochemical. Why it is called as a physicochemical process? Because there are many chemical changes, redox reactions, reduction, oxidation occurs during that. Physico, because it depends on the availability of light using energy of photons. See, option C is the answer for question 23. Now we'll go to question number 24 of all of you concentrate. Question number 24, photosynthesis is important and is the basis of life on in this question. Photosynthesis is the primary source. What do you think about this statement? 100% this statement is right, because it is the primary source of all food. Whatever food is available, it is mainly because of the green plants who are able to trap the solar energy, convert the solar energy into chemical energy. So definitely statement is right. Photosynthesis is responsible for the release of oxygen into atmosphere, 100%. Whatever available oxygen is there presently, who is contributing to that means 100% the photosynthesis process. So A and B, the statements, both these statements are right, children. So let us see the other statements. Question number 24 we are discussing. Yes, we have the other statements here. Yes. You can see here, C statement is both A and B, and D statement is none of the above. So, straight away, we need not give a second thought on this. Option C is the answer for this question. Okay. So, you all have understood, I feel. Option C is the answer. Now, let us go to question number 25. Which of the following are called accessory pigments? Okay. Right. Okay, accessory pigments. In photosynthesis, you should know that there are pigments are categorized into two types, students, primary pigments and accessory pigments. Okay, so which is the primary pigment? Always, always remember that chlorophyll A is called as the primary pigment. Okay, chlorophyll is called actually by one multiple names. One is it is called primary pigment. Another, it is also called as universal pigment. I told why it is universal, because it is present in all oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, so it is universal and it is primary. Why it is primary? What is the meaning of primary? Primary pigment is one which converts the light energy into chemical energy. The one major pigment which is actually doing the conversion of light energy into chemical energy, that pigment is called primary pigment. Remaining pigments who are doing the supporting role and helping this primary pigment are included under the category of accessory pigments. So which of them are called accessory? So definitely A, chlorophyll, chlorophyll A if you take, okay, first option, then chlorophyll B, then carotenoids, then xanthophylls. Okay, so what, chlorophyll A we should not include here, because it is acting as mainly primary pigment. Chlorophyll B accessory, carotenoids accessory, and xanthophylls accessory. So option number C, B, C, D. B, C, D would be the proper answer for this. Option C is the answer. Okay. So accessory pigments, what do? I have already said they trap the light energy and transfer to chlorophyll A. Okay. Not directly. They are not involved in direct conversion, but you can say indirectly. Okay. So directly, who is involved? Chlorophyll A. That's why option C, B, C, and D is the answer for this question. Question number 26, we'll see now. Which of the following does not play any role in photosynthesis? Okay. Phycocyanin, phycoerythrin, anthocyanin, xanthophylls. Which does not have role in photosynthesis? Phycocyanin, phycoerythrin. Let me tell you about these two. These two are the photosynthetic pigments which are found in algae. Which are found in algae, not in higher plants. Okay, in algae. Okay, which algae? You know, algae are divided into three groups: chlorophyce, pheophyce, rhodophyce. Okay, so in those groups of algae, these two pigments are doing photosynthesis, so they are having a role. Xanthophyll, in the previous questions only I said that if they come under carotenoids, okay, yellow colored pigments, they are also doing photosynthesis. Anthocyanin is not having any role in photosynthesis. Okay, so then what are these pigments? These pigments are present in the sap vacuole of plants. Okay, where they are present in the sap vacuoles. Whereas if you take this A, B, and D, they are present in chloroplasts, not in vacuoles. Whereas C is present in vacuoles and they don't do photosynthesis. Then what do they do? Okay, question will be raised. What do they do actually? They are playing a role to provide beautiful colors to the petals, sepals of the plant body. Okay, understanding? Sepals usually chloroplast only will contribute. Petals, which are of different beautiful colors, they are actually contributed by the pigments anthocyanin. So they don't play a role in photosynthesis. That's why C would become the answer for question number 26. Question number 27, besides water and light, which is most essential raw material for food formation? Okay, we know that the reaction multiple times you have seen earlier, CO2 plus H2O, okay, in the presence of light. So what is the answer? Definitely A, CO2 is the answer, because this is the essential raw material for food. Food means glucose formation. CO2 is the answer. Oxygen is the product there. Mineral salts directly are not related. NAD is not used here. So CO2 is the answer for question number 27. Now question number 28. Again, similar question only. We have already discussed. Correct equation for photosynthesis is asked here. So students, option A, we have to reject, because option A, glucose is oxidized. It is not photosynthesis. This option A is respiration. So this is not the answer. Option B, shall we go for option B? No, because multiple times I said 6H2O reaction is not biologically balanced. Option B is not the answer. Option C, 100% is the answer. 12 molecules of water are used up. Okay, the answer. Question number 29. Dark reaction in photosynthesis is called so because, okay. So you know that in photosynthesis, the process of photosynthesis is different. One is the light phase, another one is dark phase. In light phase, that light energy is done, whereas in our dark reaction, non-availability of light in the absence of light. So why dark? That is a question. Alone is wrong. It is indirectly dependent on light as such. So occurring only down option B, if you see, it does energy 100%. I have already said it depends on light, but indirectly. So direct requirement of light is not there. Hence, it is called as dark reaction. Option B is the right answer. Option C also will see it cannot occur during daytime is wrong. It can happen during day or it can happen in. So C is not the answer. It is more rapidly at night is also. So what is the answer for this question? Option B. 29, option B. 30, the process of taking in CO2 by question, what is it? Very simple photosynthesis. Okay, so transpiration, you know, already in transport, loss of water we have discussed, respiration, breakdown of glucose, endosmosis, intake of water by the cell. Okay, so option D, photosynthesis, is the right answer. Okay,
madam,
so
madam.
Today, yes sir, I'm stopping.
Yes, yes.
Ha, sir.
Okay,
yeah, we'll stop. So today I've discussed 30 questions. In the next session, we'll continue, students. Okay? Thank you.